I'm at the Mac Customer Center. Right ahead, you can see the the bulldog, the mascot. I just want. Yes. And they have some old trucks here, because this is also a museum. Wow. I was afraid I'd be stuck somewhere here behind the building with nowhere to turn around. Okay. Open the truck in there. Hi.
Hi.
Yeah, what are
you here for?
I'm just unloading this cab.
And I was afraid something like this might happen, because you know, the address on my paperwork said Mac Customer Center, and I know that's where they have a museum. You know, it's not the factory. It's just see, they have some brand new trucks here, so it's all basically for exhibition. Guy says he doesn't have a forklift with big enough forks to unload me. So, well, we'll wait. And unloading is done with two forklifts. Come on. Acquiring data. This thing. So they use two forklifts, and actually they use the smarter way. Then the guys in at the show, because they just pulled this thing from one side, of the trailer, you know. And turns out this cab does not have an engine in it, so it's not that heavy. So just two forklifts came from one side, one guy put the long forks under, and the other guy tied a strap to the rear, to the frame. And these are all brand new trucks. This is where they have the museum. Okay, I need to go this way. I like this one, this black Mac. What? What's this way? That's what they're doing. It looks like here they have a testing ground. That's why there's so many new trucks in here. See over here? So that's the asphalt right in front of us. And now you'll see a white and blue Mac. Check this out. You see? That's the testing facility. Huh. They can go fast, because that's probably like their own little freeway. And now I need to rush, because the other LTL, that partial staircase, people are really waiting for it. Well, bye bye Bulldog. See you next time.
Thank you for visiting the Mac Customer Center.
I never thought I'd be here, you know. I wanted to come because when I wanted to see my truck being assembled and they canceled the visitation, and my salesman says, well, you can still go see the museum. And this is where the museum is, right? For Mack trucks. But it didn't seem such a...
Continue 600 meters, then turn right on Grams Road.
It didn't seem such a hot idea, you know, to drive 450 miles just to see a museum.
Keep right towards I-95.
Started as a rain, temperature was like plus 4 Celsius, now it's plus 1. And as you can see, it's wet snow. And I'm heading to Connecticut. Connecticut, USA, to pick up a load for Ontario. Very dangerous conditions because I was just walking in the at the rest area and the pavement feels slippery. Check out the sign on the right. All trucks banned I-84. And I was supposed to take that one from I-684 to 84 to go east into Connecticut. And of course, that's why it's cool to have a GPS. So I just put in, I checked how far that exit was. It was like 4 kilometers, 2 miles, 2.5 miles. And so I went into tools on my Garmin and I just chose a detour longer than that distance, right? Like 5 kilometers or 3 miles. And right away it found me a local highway I can take to bypass this.
1.8 kilometers. Keep left on I-684.
And I talked to another guy at this little rest area, and he says, yeah, that's what he's gonna do. He's gonna take this Highway 22 or 202 and go east, and it goes parallel to 284. And my truck is empty, and once again, it's struggling with the empty trailer. You know what they do? They cut the power. The computer cuts the power when you are empty. And plus, it's now basically freezing temperature. Yeah, you see, I cannot go there. I cannot go 84 east. I gotta take exit 10. And I just hope that there's not a cop in there that says, oh, you know, you cannot take this either. And I'll say, officer, you should, you know, the sign says trucks banned on I-84. Now look at this. This guy is turning. Is he crazy? They told him no trucks. No trucks. And he's going there.
Left on I-684.
Huh. Anyway, that's what I need. I need I-684. Okay, what's my exit? My exit is
in 1 kilometer. Take exit 10 on right to US 6.
Another idea. Well, this is awful. Oh, and I passed another sign that said heavy snow expected. Before it was just bad conditions, and then it says bad heavy snow. Okay, what is this?
Okay. Take exit 10 on right to US 6.
Lots of exodus today. The guy that just passed, there was a medic. call from dispatch. I'm about 50 miles away, 80 kilometers away from my pickup in Connecticut. And guess what? Today is Wednesday, one day before the Thanksgiving. And these people, the shipper, kept us on the hook whole day. Yesterday they would not come in, they would not tell yes or no. And that's why I spent the night in New York, right? And it's 2 hours away, this pickup in Connecticut. 2 hours away. And you saw what the weather is like now, and they only told us that, yeah, you know, they gave us the green light only in the morning. And I started driving, and because of the weather, like right now we're doing, what, 50 miles an hour? And it's 23 minutes past 12. So basically, I would be there at somewhere like 1:30, right? And these guys are calling and complaining that they close shop at 12 o'clock today. 12 o'clock. And no matter what my dispatcher tried to, you know, to offer them, like discounts, you know, a discounted rate, anything. Not a single person was willing stay at work just one more hour, you know. And so I lost the load. So now they told me just to find a safe place to park somewhere and basically lay over, because today's Wednesday. I have a load, but it loads Friday in Ontario. Like a very nice load, finally something big and heavy that I really want. Call me crazy, but I want to haul something heavy. That was the whole point with this 7-axle monster rig apparat, right? Apparatus. And they found me a 75,000 pound drilling machine. Drilling rig? Yes. I don't care about fuel mileage. I just want to do something big and heavy. Because otherwise, what's the point of calling yourself Heavy Haul TV, right? So you gotta be, because people are already laughing at me. Hey, you call yourself Heavy Haul TV, how come, you know, you haul Mexican space stations at at or below 10,000 pounds, you know? There's nothing I could say to those people. So, but anyway, so today's Wednesday. Tomorrow's Thanksgiving, and I'm loading in Ontario Friday. So, you know, you do what you gotta do, you know, but this is, I'm just mentioning this. I'm not blaming anyone. It's basically bad weather, and people take a long time to think, you know, if they want a truck or not before the holidays. So probably they decided, you know, it's not such a important load that can wait after Thanksgiving. But the problem is, because normally when this Thanksgiving happens in the States, and you see like now, it's middle of the week, right? They're gonna be no work till Monday here, no work. And that's why, you know, I'll just sit. If there's nothing, like tomorrow I'll just go empty, because that load pays very well. And it's only 9 feet wide. I'll just do that one, you know? Like I mentioned, this is the reality of trucking, and so when you're an owner-operator, of course all this money I spend on fuel comes out of my pocket. I don't make any money when I'm empty, which actually I still like better than being paid by the mile, like average, you know, like some companies, they pay you, I don't know, $1.40, $1.50 on all miles. I believe you can still make more money with this setup when you get a percentage of the load and you're not paid for empty miles. This is what they call in Russia, "stильная оплата." Basically, you get a percentage of the deal. That's how you make serious money. You cannot make serious money by cents per mile. Never. So I'm not upset. You know. I'm just glad that there is some nice load finally that I can use my trailer for. And I just canceled the route, the active route on my GPS.
Keep right onto I-84 East.
And I put in a request to find me a truck stop somewhere nearby.
Continue 13 kilometers on I-84 east.
And turns out there is a TA truck stop in somewhere, like right on 84. And I know it's not a very good one because it's always overcrowded, but maybe today because of the holidays, maybe it shouldn't be as bad. Plus now it's only 12:30. So it's 14 kilometers away, or what is it, 8 miles? 7 miles. And that would be, then I can go in and have my Thanksgiving brunch. Huh. Now, some guys like that Russian song I sang yesterday. And one thing I wanted to mention is that back in the 30s, right before the World War, the Second World War, after communists, you know, seized power, there was a huge era of construction going on, like especially in the far regions of Russia, and that's when they had, you know, communists, and also there was a Komsomol. Komsomol is kind of like a young communist league or whatever, kind of like people that would later become communists. And it was obligatory, pretty much, that you had to be, what is this here? Wow. Okay, let's stop at close traffic here. The guy lost his tarp. Lost his tarp, and so I stopped my truck so that I'm blocking the two lanes, and I have my flashing light on so that nobody kills this poor guy. His other tarp on the deck was unstrapped as well. Maybe he hit someone. Look at this guy. What's going on? Oh yeah, he had some. This guy that just stopped, he had some bungee cord around his tire. So So that the trucker probably had bungee cords on his tarps, not straps, and those bungee cords, you know, came undone, and he lost the tarp. I hope he didn't hit the car. But anyway, what I was trying to say is that, yeah, back in the 30s, right before the Second World War, it was a big propaganda campaign all over the news, and that Komsomol, or young communists, were sent to the end of the world, like far east, you know, basically taiga, tundra, kind of like Alberta in Canada here. And they were building stuff, like they were building high voltage power lines, you know, hydro stations, anything. And it was the party line, the communist party line, that it was very cool to be one of those guys. And so they wrote this song. And the guy sings in Russian, saying that some people are chasing money, but he just wants to go there for the smell of taiga, of wild forest, and to see the fog, you know, kind of like, it was a song to encourage romantics to go to these far off construction sites, you know. And so some people wrote the anti-campaign song, saying that only fools chase the fog and the smell of tundra. We go after the money. And that's what I was thinking. So sorry for the long explanation, but it's, you need to know the context in which this song, because it's a very complicated matter. It's not just, you know, a thing of translation, like translate the words, because it would not give you the context how people were basically brainwashed into quitting their lives and going to and live in tents in the middle of the forest. Bunch of cops. What happened? Away. Cops changed lanes. He did. You see cops on the right, and I'm flashing my lights at this guy, and he's not changing the lane. Oh, the guy just smashed into the guardrail. About this dual windshield is that, of course, it saves money when you crack it, but right now you cannot see it, but I have a huge mass of ice in front, I mean in the middle, because, you know, of course my wipers don't go there.
Turn right on there at the corner for return pike.
Okay, of course here we gotta go very wide. In between the curb. Okay, no. Just as soon as I said that, he decided to go. But this is US, not Quebec, right? So we can turn right after full stop on the red light. When I punch in home, you know, like I save my parking area address as home. And this thing says, you know, in a very nice tone, it says, arriving home. But my truck doesn't want to drive today. Like I mentioned, because it's empty. Okay, now I want to show you guys what this truck stop looks like. Jesus. Okay, in the place. Well, I'm okay with pain because I'm gonna... Okay, due to the weather, the booth is closed. It will be reopened on December 1st at midnight. We will start charging at 2 a.m. Save your receipts. December 1st. Okay. So until December 1st, it's free. Cool. I like free. Call me weird, but I like it. Alright, so now we're gonna find parking. favorite place to park is somewhere away from the truck stop. And away from fuel pumps. You know, like, I don't want to park somewhere near the exit, because then you have trucks cruising by at all times of day. So we're gonna stop somewhere here. There's a guy behind me. Oh, there was someone in the wreck over there. It's a very bad angle. This would be a good place to park right next to that Sierra England, except that that's a reefer, and you know, you don't want to park to a reefer, in case someone is wondering why, because it gets very cold about within like 10 feet of the trailer because of that super powerful reefer unit. It gets very cold and your engine freezes up, and basically you gotta keep your Webasto bunk heater at a high RPM. But this guy doesn't seem to care because it's also a CRE. So I guess maybe they cancel each other out when there's two CRE England reefer units. Oh yeah, yeah, that's what I think. That's what's happening. It's like a you know, magnet, like two positive pieces of a magnet. They cancel each other, but then I think I'm not gonna go here. I see another potential spot. And you know, we drivers, we like, you know, like, there's a reason why this guy wants to park next to a CR England, because he's CR England, right? So they're gonna have tea together, maybe play cards, you know. But we all like to park next to the same type of trailer. You know, if you see a flatbed guy or stepdad guy, quite often they will try to park somewhere where they see a flatbed guy. And what I'm telling you guys all this is because I just saw a heavy haul trailer. Well, this guy is almost done anyway. I see a heavy haul trailer. Yeah, I wanted to park next to this guy. And that's my final position. I kind of went back, there's lots of parking here and I'm not in the way, and I was able to back all the way towards the rear of the spot. But this is one awful weather, ladies and gentlemen. So, let's see, how many miles did it today? Probably not too many. I started at 46.08 and I ended at 47.14. That's miles on my odometer. 46.08. 106 miles. Wow. I guess that's good.
Oh, here's a crowd's favorite. Kenworth W900. There's another truck over there. Red Freightliner Classic with looks like a very cheap steel, old steel trailer. Even the wheels are steel. Actually, this is the kind of truck that, you know, I liked when I was thinking about buying a truck. I wanted to get this one. Hey, see, that's the... Come on. So, yeah, that's the best way when you can... go forward, except that this guy is going right into me. Like, where are you going? Well, now we'll have a chance to practice probably my air horn. Yeah. That's it. You got it. He's trying to back next to me. But in general, at a truck stop, it's very important how to choose the spot where you leave your truck. Because if it's too difficult for people to back into that space, they will hit you. And like it happened to me with my international, right? They don't even leave you a holiday card, you know? Oh, and this place is called Plantsville, Connecticut. So I'm gonna mark this on my logbook. And now I can go in and have some food finally for the first time during the day. So. Yeah, it's gonna be, once again, it's gonna be a very long video, but I got some positive comments from that 40-minute video, so let's see what you guys and gals say now. So, from Plantsville, Connecticut, 57 meters above the sea level, I'm Uncle Sergeant.